Well, thank you all very much for joining this workshop. Today I will give a hands-on tutorial on using the adaptation pathway generator. And the idea is to really give you some hands-on experience with using the tool. This tutorial will run at 2 o'clock, 2:30, and 3 o'clock. So I assume you're all here to learn to work with the adaptation pathway generator. And what I actually will do, I will shortly introduce you to the concept of dynamic adaptive policy pathways, which is basically the fancy scientific term we use for these pathways. I will quickly introduce you to the case study we will be modeling in this session. And the focus of this session will be on working with the actual executable tool, so you can do pathways yourself. So I recommend that you install the pathways generator on your personal computer. You can find a link here. I also put it in the chat. It's a really lightweight tool. I think you don't even need to install. You will just get some executable in your documents, which you can run. And you can follow along. So why would you actually want to make adaptive policy pathways? Well, you all know that the magnitude and the rate of climate change is deeply uncertain, meaning that we are limited in our ability to predict what will happen in the future. And this is a problem for policymakers because they don't want that their policy has to change every time that a new climate scenario is published. And as an illustration, I included this image, which I found on Twitter, where somebody reflected on the degree of sea level rise, which were predicted in the latest publications. And you can see that actually over time, the uncertainty on sea level rise even increased. So this is problematic for policymakers. Because yeah, you make your policy and you don't want to redo it every time such a new report comes out. So the objective of dynamic adaptive policy pathways is to develop a policy that is independent of the climate scenario, so you don't have to change it when a new publication comes in. So this is typically how adaptive policy pathways look. On the left-hand side, you will see a series of actions, and those actions have a certain best before date or a terminal. You will recognize the meter map idea this was based on. So if you take the yellow action, actually it will no longer hold than 9 years, for example. Those terminal stations are also called adaptation tipping points. Of course, you can transfer from one action to another, and these are indicated by the circles. And yeah, you might wish to give your actions different colors depending on how effective they are in certain scenarios. Today, we will think of ourselves as living on a small island in a beachside village. And we all live nicely close to the beach in our houses, but we have a problem. Annually, we see that the shoreline actually retreats. And during storm surges, we see that big parts of the beach are eroded. So as island inhabitants, we formulated our policy objective as to mitigate the impacts of any potential continuing coastal retreat and temporary storm surge erosion. So we want to protect us against the sea. Well, as island inhabitants, we have seen all these nice visualizations, but we can't see the forest for the trees because there's so many things you can do. So how to do it? Well, we first need to sit together and scope and identify our policy actions. So the island people sit together and decide on a policy horizon, which is still policy relevant, say 2100. And they also make their targets a bit more formal. So they say the minimum distance from our house to the high tide line under cold conditions should be larger than 100 meter. And there can be incidents during storm surges, but that should not do damage to more than 10 houses a year. Well, then they had another look at this Twitter image and they actually said, well, let's consider three sea level rise scenarios called low, which is half a meter in 2100, moderate, which is 1.5 meter in 2100, and high end sea level rise, which is 2.5 meter in 2100. And they, in this scenario, also anticipate, for example, the collapse of the West Antarctic ice sheet. Then again, they look into their environment and consider, well, what can we actually do to protect our area? And they actually come up with three different actions. We can build a seawall, which protects us against 0.75 meter sea level rise. We can actually replenish or nourish the beach that will protect us against 1.3 meter sea level rise. Or we could evacuate and do not allow building below a certain setback lines. And actually we can deal with that for a very long time. So here again, if you look at the meter map at the right-hand side, you can see the concept of a meter map and an action. You can compare that with choosing the color of the line. So imagine we take our starting point here in the middle of the Brussels road network, and we want to head to the west, and we choose to go for the purple action. We cannot go further than Gare de l'Ouest, where we should switch to another action if we actually want to go to station 5, for example. So I suggest that you now start the executable and follow me in generating the pathways for the small island state. I will wait for 1 minute here so you can see if you can run the executable from your own computer. And I will also now have a look at the chat to see if there's any question at this point. So I will restart the pathway generator because you will probably see a different screen when you open it. And different from what I'm seeing here. So let me now continue. If you start the executable, you will see this window and gives you the opportunity to make different types of pathways. But today we will focus on creating condition-based policy pathways. So let's click the condition-based pathways. I have to reshare my screen now. There we are. You should see something like this, which is the pathways generator main screen. And I first want to show you how you actually can change the interface a little bit. Currently, we only see an overview of the pathway map. But if we click this button here, you can also list the actions that are currently implemented in the model. If you click it again, you will only see the actions. And if you click it once more, you will only see the pathway map. So let's start with changing some settings in our model, which can be done by hitting this settings button. I already introduced that we want to look into sea level rise with a maximum of 250 centimeters. So let's add it as a max value and let's put on the x-axis that we are looking into sea level rise in centimeters. Now, settings all done. We can see that our scale actually changed from 0 to 250, so that works well. So let's now start with adding actions to this model. We can have actions by hitting the plus button and choose add action. Now, our first idea was to construct a seawall. So let's try if we can make an action for that. Let's make it red. And we also figured out that a seawall will protect us against 75 centimeters of sea level rise. We don't need this opportunity tipping point window today. There we are. We created our first action, our first meter line. And we can actually make it a bit nicer by switching this. Don't switch the vertical button, because then you will change the adaptation tipping point of this action, which we want to be at 75. If you change it, for example, like this, you can change it back here at the right-hand side by typing 75 in the condition window. I actually have a question for the host or the technical coordinator, if you can see my mouse, because if you don't, I should be a bit more explicit in what I tell you about the interface.
I can see it. I can see it.
You can see the mouse. That's great. That makes it a bit easier. So we added our first action, the seawall, which protects us against 75 centimeters. Let's also add the other actions. Beach replenishment. Let's make that orange. Beach replenishment, which protects us against 130 centimeters of sea level rise. And let's add the setback lines. Which protect us against 180 centimeters of sea level rise. So there we are. As you can see, you can also put your actions on a different location. And in this case, I want to make a distinction between retreat scenarios like setback lines and more hold the line approaches, which I put on the top. Well, you can see that each action has a tipping point, the terminal of the action, which corresponds to the best before date of this action. Well, let us now develop some adaptive pathways. Let's imagine that we started building a seawall, but then later we complemented that by beach replenishments. So we will add the plus button and add a pathway. So the first action we did would be to construct the seawall, and after a certain point we would switch to doing beach replenishments. And now we know that if we build a seawall, that does not help us at all in the beach replenishment strategy. So the tipping point of the combined action, seawall and beach replenishment, will still give us a tipping value of 130. And know that you have to here put the sequence button, because what we here will do is first build the seawall, and if that one does no longer work, we will demolish the seawall basically, and then switch to a beach replenishment strategy. So here you can see our first adaptive pathway. We build our seawall, then at a point where it does no longer protect us anymore, we will demolish the seawall and follow the beach replenishment strategy to the end, where it does no longer protect us as well. What we also could do is a pathway where we start with building the seawall, and when the seawall does no longer protect us, we switch to setback lines. So again, it's a sequential path which tips at 180 centimeters, just as the setback lines. So you can see our second pathway, where we start with a seawall, then it does no longer protect us, build or implement the setback lines. Well, what the final thing we could do is add a pathway which starts with a beach replenishment and which then changes to implementing setback lines. This also tips at 180 centimeters. So in this case, we would actually replenish the beach till we can no longer do that. And only at that point, we will urge the people to move to a new location by implementing the setback lines. So now we have made three pathways which are all based on sequential actions. However, you can also imagine that you can combine actions, meaning that the first action you will still help you a little bit when you also implement the second action. So let us imagine that we start with building the seawall. I'm pressing the wrong button. We add a pathway where we actually first create the seawall, but then at the same time, we will also replenish the beach. And we know that actually if we don't break down the seawall after when we start replenishing the beach, that we can actually deal with a little bit more sea level rise. Let's say it's 170 centimeters. So the seawall will still be there, and we put sand in front of the seawall. And we know that the combined action, so we put this on combine, will protect us against 170 centimeters of sea level rise. So that will look like this. Oh, I shouldn't do that. Let me correct it. This is 170 centimeters, and let's make it a bit more nicer. So in this pathway, you can actually see that we still have the seawall in the strategy, and at a certain point, we will start replenishing the beach without demolishing the seawall. Well, let's do one other combined action, a pathway where we start with replenishing the beach, and then implement setback lines. It's a combined action. And let's say that if you replenish the beach, so the beach remains a little bit longer, and you also evacuate where necessary using the setback lines, you can actually deal with 250 centimeters of sea level rise. So that's basically a strategy which works till the end. Well, if you look at my screen now and you followed along on your own computer, you will have a pathway that looks something like this, a metro map which looks like this. So the only thing which is now missing is actually scenarios, because we know the amount of sea level rise, but we don't know when this actually will occur. So to do that, we move to our next tab, which is scenarios. So let's go there. And here we can actually add new climate scenarios. So we press the plus button here. And let's see if this is all right. I have to change one setting here, excuse me. So we don't go to the plus, but first we go to the double arrowed icon, and we enter the beginning year, which is 2020, and put the number of time steps to 80. It could be that this is already the default on your machine. So then again, we go to the plus scenario, and we add the name of our scenario, which was low sea level rise. And let's make that green. So let's put in the first cell 2020 and zero sea level rise. And in the last cell, so you scroll all the way down, you put 2100 and 1.5 meters sea level, which is 50 centimeters. Recall that we are still dealing with centimeters. And then it should manually interpolate for all the years until 2100. That seems to work. I hope it also works on your machines. Let's add the other scenarios in a similar fashion. So we add an orange scenario, moderate sea level rise, and we put the sea level rise in 2100 to 150, That should all, that looks all nice. It interpolates to 150 centimeters. And we end with high and sea level rise, which we make yellow, red because we don't like it. And we make, we put the value of 2.5 meters here. Okay, so let's check. This all looks nice. Great, so we implemented the scenario. So let's see what that is doing to our pathways visualization. Ah, that looks really nice. So we already, I see one problem which we will fix first. You can see that our old axis sea level rise is sort of in the middle of our meter map now, which we don't like. So I believe we can change that here by pressing the settings button and just making the graph settings and making the height of the figure a bit larger. So let's make it to 700 pixels. Ah, there we are. This looks much better. We have the sea level rise scale still here below the graph. And then if we scroll down a bit, we can see our low sea level rise scenario, our moderate sea level rise scenario, and our high-end sea level rise scenario. And the unit here is years, meaning that we can now see the time basically on the x-axis. So basically, this is the visualization we were aiming at. So we have made our first pathway. And I see we have a couple of more minutes, so we can talk a little bit on the interpretation of this. So what this visualization helps us to figure out which pathways are preferable over other ones. And what we actually see if we, for example, start with building the seawall, in the low sea level rise scenario, we will be fine. In a moderate sea level rise scenario, we would have actually to change to a combination with seawall and beach replenishment, or we should change to setback lines at a certain point. But we can also see that if we start with building the seawall, we will never be adaptive enough to deal with the high-end sea level rise scenario. So maybe building the seawall is not a very good idea, because in the end it will never protect you against the high-end sea level rise. Or maybe you take the risk and you still do it because you have very strong reasons to choose otherwise. We also see that, for example, beach replenishment is quite a good option because it will protect us now. And at a certain point, we actually could still build the seawall later if it seems to be necessary, because the sea level rise was more than in the low scenario. Or we could even combine it with implementing setback lines in a certain moment. And if we would follow that strategy, we could even deal with the most extreme sea level rise scenario in our model. Well, all these evaluation criteria for different, which prefer different pathways over others, you could actually fill in here in the scorecard. Here you can add like a nice plus or a minus for each action. So say that the seawall is really cheap, but it's very nasty for the view of your beach. You could do it like this, and based on these kind of visualizations, you could actually make your own cost benefit analysis, at least in a very qualitative way. And of course, if you want to export your first meter map, you could click here on the left hand top and export it to a PNG image or an EMF image, which you then can make more fancy in your favorite design software. That was it for the demo. I hope that this helped. I will move back to the presentation for my final slides. The hands-on is finished. This is more or less what you should have made, and it's similar to what I just made in the generator tool. And here you can see one way to evaluate the scorecard for some actual study we did. And of course, you could also make this more quantitative or do the stakeholder session. If you want to read more on the whole approach in a bit more systematic way, I took you through it in a rather intuitive way, but from a science side, it can be done a bit more systematic. Have a look at Marjolein's paper, which has these kind of visualizations guiding you through the whole process. So that was it. I hand over to the host, technical coordinator, to tell us what is next.
If there are any questions. Otherwise, we wait for 1-2 minutes and then you can start again for other people joining.
Maybe you can send a screenshot if you manage to do a visualization yourself. That would be nice. If you have any questions which pop up later or need any technical support on the tool, you can always reach me by email or through any other channel. I see a question. This seems more like a tool to illustrate scientific knowledge to policymakers, not for policymakers to use directly, right? Yeah, you can see it as a sort of object to visualize the outcomes of research. But on the other hand, you can also make these ones yourself if you have if you want to visualize some strategy which you plan for a certain area. It could be a very handy tool. So we have seen both things actually, like scientists making pathways for a client, the policymaker, or also people making them themselves. On the question of Gijs, was this method used for the advice to the Delta program in the Netherlands? Yes, this is actually a formal method used for planning water resources in the Netherlands. I think longer than only last year already. The question of NAS, can one plug in scenarios from external documents? That's a good question. Actually, I don't know. I can imagine that you can copy paste your time series from a CSV file or something, but we should try it out. Yeah. I mean, if you have an existing time series from, for example, the SROC IPCC report, I think you can just copy paste them in the column where I just interpolated all the values from 1 to the end of the sea level rise range. I also see an image. Let's see. Ah, nice. I see a very nice pathways generated by Vladimir. Really nice. Great to see that it works. So thank you all very much. I think it's now time to switch to another session. For you, if you want to see another tutorial, or if you stay with me, you will get the same tutorial once more. And for the people now coming in, welcome. Feel free to send me questions by email. Thank you very much for joining.
Okay, we wait for other 2 minutes for new people coming to take part in the tutorial session. For the newcomers, you can use the chat to make questions or raise your hand.
Well, welcome all to this tutorial on using the adaptive pathway generator. My name is Kees Verginkel. I work in Deltares and also pursue a PhD at VU University in Amsterdam. And the objective of today is that you actually yourself can make adaptive pathways using a tool. And maybe the technical coordinator can share the link to the tool again in the chat. So the link is on top in the chat and you can download it from there. What I will do is I will introduce the concept of dynamic adaptive policy pathways, give a short introduction to a case study, which we will use to make pathways ourselves. And the core of this presentation will be an actual hands-on exercise to work with pathway generator. So please install the pathway generator. It's a very easy tool downloadable from the link in the chat. And on this Wikipedia page, you can also find more information on how the tool works. Well, why should you, after all, want to make adaptive policy pathways? Well, in general, it holds that the magnitude and the rate of climate change is very uncertain. So what often happens is that new climate scenarios comes in and that you will have to alter your policy based on this scenario. Well, adaptive policy pathways were developed as a scenario independent approach. So actually it is meant to have a generic strategy or policy, which does not have to be changed when new climate projections comes in. And this is very handy, is illustrated by this picture, which I just took from Twitter. Here you can see how the extent of sea level rise actually changed over some documents that were published over the last years. So an adaptation pathway will roughly look like this. We have a couple of different actions, so A, B, C, D. And in this case, some actions will not work for the entire period we are considering. For example, action B will only work for 8 years and action C for 85 years. So these points are called adaptation tipping points, or I like to think of them as terminals or best before dates of a certain action. And if such an adaptation point is reached, you want to switch to another action which will actually help you to survive with your policy to the end of the century. So today we are imagining that we are living on a small island. And we all have a nice house somewhere here on the beach, in the line with the forest. And this is a small beach. And what we actually notice is that each year the shoreline retreats and that our houses are at risk of being eroded, especially when the storm surges hit the island. So a bit more formally, we have formalized our policy objective as to mitigate the impacts of any potential continuing coastal retreat and temporary storm surge erosion. So unfortunately, those inhabitants of the island can't see the forest for the trees. They've seen all these nice visualizations, but they wonder how they can do it themselves. So let's give them a hand and start with a nice scoping and action workshop. So let's agree on a policy horizon for this island. Let's say that they want to be safe till the year 2100. That is their policy relevant horizon. And let's formalize the targets and indicators a bit by saying that the minimum distance from houses to the high tide line under cold conditions should be larger than 100 meter, and that we accept some flooding each year during extreme events, but that shouldn't be more than 10 houses. Let me have a quick look at the chat, if there's anything. No, nothing I have to answer now. So let's also say that we agree on the scenarios we want to consider. We have a low sea level rise of 0.5 meter, we have a moderate sea level rise of 1.5 meter, and we have a high-end sea level rise of 2.5 meter in 2100. And this one also accounts for the collapse, the potential collapse of the West Antarctic ice sheet. So it's really high-end. Now, let's see what we can do actually to protect ourselves against these storm surges. We can build a seawall, and some consultant told us that that helps us against 0.75 meter. We can do replenishment or nourishment of the beach, which will protect us against 1.3 meter of sea level rise. And finally, we could implement setback lines, which will protect us against 1.8 meter sea level rise. Now, I want to take you to this visualization of the Brussels Metro network, and imagine that we want to start here in the center and we want to head west. Then an action would actually be taking the purple line. So imagine we took the action, the purple line, and we can see we head to the west a little bit, but at a certain point we can't go further. We end up at the terminal of our station, which is Gare de l'Ouest. And at that point, we would have to switch to another action, switch to another line, so we could go west either even further. And those points, those terminals, are called adaptation tipping points. So I suggest that you now move on to the to this link and try to start the pathways executable, which will be downloaded somewhere on your computer. I will do that as well. Let me share. So let me now share my pathway generator screen, and you will see this window. I hope you can now see the window, and actually we can make two types of pathways, but today we will focus on condition-based pathways. So click that button. I have to reshare my window again. And you're supposed to see a window like this. So let me first point you to a very handy button, which is the view button. If you press that one, you could change your view. So if you change this, you can only see the pathway which we will generate. If you click it again, you will see the actions and the pathway. If you click it once more, you will only see the actions. So that can be helpful. Well, let's start with changing some settings in the generator. We do that by clicking the wheel button, and let's insert here the limit of our climate or sea level rise scenario. So let's set the max value to 250 centimeters, and let's put the x-axis caption on sea level rise in centimeters. There we are. Now you should see that here on the x-axis you have a nice range where you can see the degree of sea level rise. So let us now add some actions. We do it by hitting the plus button. So it's here, then add action. So let's name our first action C. Let's make it red. And let's put in the adaptation tipping points, which we just set on 75 centimeter, if you recall. We don't need to do anything here in the opportunity tipping points window. Well, you now inserted your first action. You can actually change the vertical position of these actions to make your visualization a bit nicer. You could also actually change the tipping point, but you have to be a bit careful here because this, of course, has to make sense. And we already know that our consultant told us that it was 75, so we shouldn't change that. I will put it back to 75. Let's also add our second action, plus add action beach tree management. And let's make that orange because after all, sand is sort of yellowish orange. And we agreed on a beach tree, that beach replenishment would help us for 130 centimeters of sea level rise. So there we are. Let's make the visual a bit better. And we have an action beach replenishment with a tipping point at 130 centimeters. Well, let's add another action, which was implementing the setback lines. And this, of course, is a very environmental friendly action. So let's make that one green and put the adaptation tipping point on 100 centimeter. And here I actually put the setback lines on the bottom because this is quite a different strategy. We would actually evacuate the people rather than doing physical interventions to the beach. So let's separate it a bit. Well, we have three actions with tipping points now. Let us develop some pathways. To develop a pathway, we would hit the plus button again and add a pathway. And let's say that the first policy path that we could take is first building the seawall, and then actually demolish the seawall and start with replenishing the beach. So that would be a sequence. Actions which have a, yeah, because we demolish the seawall and then only after that start with replenishing the beach, the tipping point of this complete pathway will also be 130 centimeters. We see that we now have a nice transfer station here. So seawall transfer to beach replenishment, and then this pathway tips at 130 centimeters. Let's do another one at pathway. Let's say we would first build a seawall and then later implementing, demolish the seawall and start implementing setback lines at the moment that the seawall is no longer functional. This also means that we first do this, then the other action, and that the tipping value is equal to the tipping value of the second action. So that would look like this. You start the seawall, then transfer to setback lines, and then follow the setback line strategy. Well, similarly, we could also add a pathway where we start with beach replenishment and actually give up on beach replenishment at a certain time. And at that point, we move on to implementing setback lines and do those two actions in sequence. So the tipping value is also 180 centimeters. So here we visualize the pathway, which we then will follow. Now, these were all sequential actions, but of course, it is also possible to do actions at the same time. And that is done in almost similar fashion. So let's go to add pathway. let's start with the action seawall, but now actually keep the seawall and do beach replenishment on top of it. And that we can indicate by not putting the arrangement on sequence, but actually hitting the combine button. If we do both actions, we can deal with more than 130 centimeters of sea level rise, but say our consultant tells us that we can deal with 170 centimeters if we put the sand in front of the seawall. That would give us a pathway like this. And let me put it a bit to the top to make it nicer. We can see that we get a dashed line here, indicating that both actions are taken, are done at the same time. So we first build a seawall, then start doing beach replenishment at a certain point. And the combined effect of that is better than only doing beach replenishment. Now, let's do a final combined action, which is a pathway where we start with doing beach replenishment and then later implement our setback lines. Well, let's say that our consultant tells us that this is a very good combination of actions and that it together will protect us against 250 centimeters of sea level rise. So again, we get this nice dashed pathway. So we start with replenishing the beach, and when that on itself is no longer viable, we also will implement the setback lines, and that will actually save us to the maximum amount of sea level rise we expect. So we have 10 more minutes. So I will show you now how to actually add the scenarios to this, because now we only have a condition and it's not connected to time whatsoever. So now we click the scenarios tab. And let's check if the settings are all right. That we do by clicking the two arrows buttons. Oh, well, we want to start in 2020, that's fine. 80 time steps, oh, that gives us 2100. So by default, the settings are already suitable for our case. We add a scenario by pressing this button and entering the name of the scenario, which is low sea level rise. And let's make it green. And you can see a lot of empty rows here, but in the first, you will have to put a zero because there's no sea level rise now. But we want to put here our time horizon, which is 2100. And indicate that this is 0.5 sea level rise. So that's our first scenario. Let's check. You see that it nicely linearly interpolated the values we just added, which is probably not entirely correct with sea level rise, but fine for now. Let's also add our moderate sea level rise and make that orange and change the value here. I made a mistake. We worked with the unit centimeters. So we should also work with centimeters here. Otherwise we'll get weird visualizations. So this should be 150 centimeters rather than 1.5 meter. Excuse me for that. You can see that now the moderate sea level rise is in centimeters. It goes up to 2100. And we actually want to remove the or change the low sea level rise value. And you can see it. It was set to 50, but 0.5, but let's change it to 50 to correct for units. That went well. So now we again have the low sea level rise, but also in centimeters. Well, let's quickly add the high and sea level rise as well. Let's make it red and put 250 here. You see it nicely interpolates. Okay, what did we make? to see that we have to go back to the pathway view. And we actually have a nice meter map now, but visualization messed a little bit up because our scale is now on top of our visualization. So we can change it by pressing the wheel button, change the graph settings to the graph height of a little bit more, let's say 700 pixels. Let's see if that will do. It will do. So now we have still have the sea level rise in the x-axis, but with some added information on the time in the different sea level rise scenarios we just inserted. Let's see how I'm doing in time. I have 5 minutes. Okay, so we can have a very small discussion on how this could help us in the planning. So imagine we would start with a seawall scenario. Actually, it does not help us till the end of the century in any of the scenarios considered. But of course, if we start with a seawall, we can switch to a beach replenishment, and then we'll at least survive the low sea level rise and the moderate sea level rise scenario. But yeah, then still, we will not survive the high-end scenario. So maybe it's not a very good idea to do that. However, if we would actually start replenishing the beach, we can actually survive for a very long time and then still switch to implementing setback lines on top of that so that we can survive even the most worst-case scenario, high-end sea level rise. Well, all those evaluation of different paths, like advantages or disadvantages, you could also add in the scorecard by adding plus and minus. So say the seawall is very cheap, it really ruins the view of the beach, we can do something like this. And in the same way, give also scores to all the combined actions. Well, the only thing left to do is to export our image. We can do that by moving back to the pathways tab and then clicking the export button. You could actually save it as a PNG or an EMF image, which you can then make even nicer in your favorite visuals editor. That was it for the demonstration. Let me quickly move back to the presentation. This is more or less what you should have. I'm very curious what you came up with. So if you want, you can make a screenshot of your visualization and put it in the chat. Well, what we could do on top of this is evaluate our pathways with a cost-benefit analysis. And for a bit more formal description of the DAP approach, I would like to reach direct you to this paper of Marjolein Haasnoot, my colleague, and there she goes through all the steps in a bit more detail. Well, for more questions, you can now use the chat. You can also send me an email later, or you can have a look at our Wikipedia page, the one you also use to download the executable. And well, that was it. Thank you very much for your attention during this workshop. There is a question on the workshop of tomorrow. Tomorrow I will give exactly the same workshop as today. So yeah, it's the same. Thank you all. Ah, a question, is there a Mac or iOS version of this software? I'm afraid not, actually. If you're working on a Mac, you can maybe use a dummy Windows installation and run it from there. Yeah, I'm sorry for that. Yeah. Please send me an email on this question and I will redirect it to the colleagues who developed the tool, because it's not available on the wiki page, I believe. But maybe it's somewhere, but not public yet. So please send me your question by email and I can redirect it to the colleagues who developed this tool. What about dynamically create the best pathways for specific sea level rise? So I interpret your question as how to find the most, like the preferred pathway, and if you can generate that automatically from the tool. Yeah, right. I think you always need to do this visually, because of course, if you do the scorecard, you could then basically just choose the alternative which works best. But in our case, we actually had a pathway. Actually, only one pathway made it to the end of the century. So maybe that is the preferred one. But maybe you have more pathways that will last under all scenarios, and then it's really a stakeholder decision, like which one they prefer. But of course, you could use the scorecard here then to make a final decision on which one you will implement. This is a free tool. You can just download it and use it for your project. And if you look into the papers which actually cite the Haasnote paper, there is hundreds of people who already made visualizations for many topics. So I've seen applications in forestry and so on. So for those who are already in the session, you can go to the link which I put in the chat, which will direct you to a wiki page of Deltares. There you will see a download link. If you click it, you can already download the tool which you will use during this tutorial. So in the chat, there is a link. If you follow the link, you will find yourself on the page, which has a download link for the executable which you will use in this session. All right, welcome everyone to this session on the pathway generator tool. Let me check. Yes, I'm sharing the right screen. So in this tutorial, I will show you how to use the generator. And the objective is that you really can make pathways yourself after this session. My name is Kees van Ginkel. I work at Deltares and also pursue a PhD at the VU University in Amsterdam. So what we will do today is I give you a short introduction to the concept of dynamic adaptive policy pathways. I do this with a small case study on an island state. And the majority of the time we will spend on a hands-on working with the pathway generator. And I strongly recommend that you follow along with this by installing the pathways generator on your own machine. You can do that by following the link displayed, and it's also in the chat. So why would you actually want to make adaptive policy pathways? Well, we know that the magnitude and the rate of climate change is deeply uncertain. And then as a consequence of that, every now and then new climate scenarios come in. And what you probably want to avoid as a policymaker is that you have to change your policies each time that a new report comes out. And to illustrate this, you can see the amount of future sea level rise, which is expected in different publications. And you can see actually in this image that the uncertainty actually grew over time. And also that there's quite differences between those ranges. So if you had to change your policy every time upon a new scenario, it's a bit annoying. And that's actually what happened in the Dutch National Adaptation Strategy. And they therefore decided to adapt our new adaptive policy pathways approach for their water management policy. So today we will develop policy pathways that are independent of the climate scenario. And what we will make is something that looks like this. So we have a list of actions. So those are the different things that you can do as a policymaker. And each action has a certain best before date, which is indicated by this adaptation tipping point, which I would like to think of as a terminal. So if you take action B, it will not last longer than 9 years in this case. If you take action C, it will not last longer than 85, or is it 83 years. Of course, if one action fails, you can still do another action, and those are indicated by these transfer stations. So in our case study, we are living on a small island. We are all living nicely somewhere here on the beachfront. And what we notice is that due to sea level rise and storm surges, the beach gets smaller. And moreover, during these storm surges, our beach erodes and it damages and floods the houses. So we as island inhabitants formalize our policy objective as to mitigate the impacts of any potential continuing coastal retreat and temporary storm surge erosion. Well, actually the inhabitants can't see the forest for the trees. They see all these nice visualizations but don't know how to make it themselves. So let's help them a little bit today. To do that, we first need to scope our problem a little bit. So let's say that our policy horizon is 2100. So we want to be safe till that point. Then we have two targets. The minimum distance from a house to the high tide line under cold conditions should be larger than 100 meters. And we want the incidence of household flooding to be smaller than 10 houses per year. Now we are dealing with three sea level rise scenarios. The first being that sea level rise will be 0.5 meter in 2100, the second that will be 1.5, and the third one that it will be 2.5 meter in 2100, and this one then also includes for a collapse of the West Antarctic ice sheet. And we actually agreed on three different things that we can do to protect our island. We can build a seawall which protects to 0.75 meter. We can replenish our beach, which protects till 1.3 meter, and we can implement setback lines, which is 1.8 meter. So this is mainly, we retreat from living so close to the beach and cannot build beyond this line. So if we look into the visualization of a meter map, you can think of an action as one of the meter lines that you take. So let's say we start here in the center and our objective is to head west. The adaptation tipping point is the point where we couldn't go further west in the purple line. So we are stuck here at Gare du West. And there we would have to switch to another action to actually go further west to, for example, Erasme station. So I suggest that you now start the executable from the wiki page of Deltares. You can do that by clicking this link. If you click the link and start the executable, you would actually see this window. And if you see this window, you have to start, click the condition-based pathway. If you click that one, you will find yourself in a window like this. I hope you now can all see my screen, where you see an empty space indicating the space where we are going to draw our pathway. So let's start with changing some settings. We do that by pressing the wheel button here and setting the max value of our x-axis to the maximum sea level rise in our scenario, which is 250 centimeters. Let's also give it a nice heading, sea level rise in centimeters. We press OK. Now here we can see the degree of sea level rise visualized on the x-axis. Well, let's now add the actions we just agreed on. To do that, we click the plus button and add an action. The first action was to build a seawall. Seawall, and the color is red. And the adaptation tipping point of this action was 75 centimeters. We don't need to do anything here with opportunity tipping point. Well, we can actually change the vertical position of the pathway a little bit to make the visualization nicer. Could also change actually the position of the tipping point, but yeah, that's not what we want to do because we already know that this is 75. So let me change that back to 75 centimeter. Let us now add our second action, which is to replenish our beach. Beach replenishment. And let's make that orange. And we figured out that that would protect us against 130 centimeters of sea level rise. So let's make this nice like this. And I think I made a typo. Wow. And let's add a final action called setback lines. That is basically to evacuate our houses behind a certain line. And let's make it green. And we already know that this is 180 centimeters from the presentation. And here I like to separate the setback lines from the other actions because it's a retreat scenario, whereas the other two actions are more holding the line. So I put them below the current situation. So now we have made our actions and we can see that each action has a tipping point at a certain degree of sea level rise. And we are ready to develop some pathways. We do that by clicking the plus button and clicking add pathway. Now, the first thing we could actually do is to build a seawall and then later choose to replenish the beach. And this actually is a sequential action, meaning that first we build the seawall. And then if it no longer functions, we demolish the seawall and start to replenish the beach instead of the seawall. So we put it on sequence. And this also means that our combined action, our pathway, is no longer viable after 130 centimeters, just like doing just a beach replenishment, because we demolished our seawall after all. So that will give you this view. Where you see the seawall, and at a certain point, if it no longer functions, you switch to a new action where you replenish the beach. What we could do alternatively is first building a seawall. So we add another pathway, building seawall, and then break down the seawall and switch to implementing setback lines at a certain point. And because we broke down the seawall, it's also the combined action will also just protect us against 180 centimeters of sea level. So that will look like this. You see that if you do this, you get these nice transition points where you can switch from one action to another, the transfer stations. Now, the final thing we can do is start with replenishing our beach and then implementing setback lines. And it also has a tipping point at 180 centimeters. So However, what we of course also can do is combined actions. So where you wouldn't demolish your seawall, but actually keep the seawall and then replenish your beach. So you do two actions basically at the same time. And that we can do in a similar fashion. We add a pathway, indicate that our first action is building the seawall, but then the second action is beach replenishment, and we do them combined. And we also know that if we combine the two actions, they will protect us against a 170 centimeter sea level. So that's not something you can draw from these figures, but that's what the consultant tells you. So let's put this one a little bit up. And we can see that this has a nice dashed line indicating that we do both the red action and the orange action at the same time. Well, let's do another combined action, being beach replenishment combined with setback lines. And let's say that those two combined protect us against 250 centimeters of sea level rise. Put a bit up to make it nice. Here you can see that if you would start with the beach replenishment, you transfer at a certain point to doing setback lines on top of beach replenishment, you could actually survive to the maximum amount of sea level rise we are considering here. Well, this was creating the pathways. And based on the actions we defined, we can actually see those by changing the view here. If you click it once, you see both the actions on top and the visualization below. If you click it again, you will see just the actions. If you click it once more, we are back to our visualization. However, this still does not account for any scenario. So let's add scenarios. You click the scenarios tab and you will see this window. And let's quickly check our settings here by pressing the two arrows. It says the begin year is 2020, which is fine. The time steps are 80, so the end year is 2112. That's exactly what you want. So let's keep it like this and add our first scenario. Our first scenario was a low sea level rise scenario. Let's make that green because it's favorable. And we scroll all the way down to indicate that in 2100, the scenario corresponds to a sea level rise of 50 centimeters. You can see that it nicely interpolates the values till the maximum amount of sea level rise. Now let us add the other scenarios, which is moderate sea level rise. Let's make it orange and put the maximum value to 150. You see this nicely interpolates, and let's quickly add our high end sea level rise. Make that red. And put it on to 250 centimeters. And that was the scenario where we also accounted for collapse of the Antarctic ice sheets. Okay, if we now go back to our pathways visualization, you see that it messed up a little bit. The scale, the x-axis is now in the midst of our figure. We can change that by changing the settings a bit. Go to graph settings and we put the graph height to 700. And what we see is that because we changed the scenario tab, the timelines of the different scenarios are now nicely put below the degree of sea level rise. This actually helps us to do a bit of interpretation of the map we created. So we can see that constructing a seawall is on itself will only protect us in the low sea level rise scenario, but it will fail in the moderate or high-end sea level rise scenarios. However, if we start with building a seawall, we can, at a certain point, always combine it with beach replenishment, and then we will still do okay in a moderate scenario, but fail in the high-end. We could also start with seawall, then move to beach replenishment or whatever. But if you really want to make it under all scenarios towards the end of the century, there's only one viable pathway, which would be to either start with beach replenishment and then start with setback lines at a certain point, or the other way around, of course. If we start with setback lines, we can transfer anywhere here to doing beach replenishment on top of it. What we typically would do is then move to the scorecard tab and actually denote if we like all these different actions. For example, we saw that the seawall did not have the targeted effect in all scenarios, but it was very cheap, so maybe we like it a little bit more. But it has a drawback that it really destroys the view for a beach, so let's indicate that here. And you can imagine that if you do this in a bit systematic way, you can have a nice discussion with stakeholders, give scores to all these variables to do a sort of weighting of your pathways. So let's say in our case that we actually prefer to replenish the beach because then we don't have to move any houses, we don't have to build the ugly seawall. And then we know that at a certain point here, we have to transfer to combining beach replenishment with the setback lines. If we do that, we actually have a safe strategy to till the end of the century. So that was it for the hands-on tool. I'm actually quite curious about what you created on your own computer. So feel free to make a screenshot and put it in the chat. I will now quickly move back to the presentation to finish my slides. And in the meantime, feel free to share your questions in the chat. We'll now move back to the PowerPoint. Here we are. So this is more or less the visualization we created. So you can do this nice pathway evaluation where you list benefits and drawbacks of each pathway or individual actions. And a bit formal way to do this whole procedure. I now did it very intuitively, but there's more scientific description. I refer you to this paper, which will describe all the different steps which would be taken in a policy process in which you would develop pathways. That was it for today. So I hope you enjoyed it and that you were able to make pathways yourself now. We have seen many applications actually in literature on pathways from forestry to, sea level rise, many other nice applications. So I'm looking forward to where you will apply it, and feel free to ask any questions now. Well, if no questions, thank you very much. You can always send me an email and we can help you out with making your own pathways. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference.